And for a child that is autistic, calming means a few things. Number one, weight. We spoke about weight, like the weighted blankets. You can try it yourself. If you just give yourself a body hug right now.
I want you guys to try this.
Right? Not light touch. We're not going like this. We're giving squeezes. Squeeze the arms. That's very calming to the body. Now do the opposite. Just go like this with your arms, with the tip of your fingers. That's arousing. So you want to think about pressure. Pressure is very important to these children. Weight is very important also. They're both very calming. So when you pick activities, and actually that's something I've been doing on the side. I've recently started a blog online to give parents all this information. I want this to be accessible. It's not difficult. Children with autism are, like I said, they're not scary. They're such wonderful, wonderful kids. And I want activities to be out there that are fun for them. A lot of things are very therapeutic looking, very medical looking. So I'm a little bit crafty, so I like to put together things that they can do and that's actually fun for them. So things with resistance, like pins, a lot of clothespins activities, this is good. It's a lot of input, a lot of putty, a lot of Play-Doh activities. These are all things that are important. We want to ground them. And ground them means exactly that. Just calm them down. And one of the best ways to do it is get on the ground and let them lie down on the floor. If they're going to be watching TV, get them to watch it lying down on the floor. If you see them getting a little too hyper in the chair, sitting down, get them on the floor. It actually calms the system. Things that are repetitive, and that's why a lot of them, you see the flapping, let's say, the flapping, the rocking, things like that, it's calming. Anything that's repetitive and that's very easy to do, they love. So sometimes they'll stack something over and over again. In therapy, we don't allow that to happen all the time. This is what we're trying to break out of. But if you need to calm a child, if you see one that has, they have very high anxiety levels in general, I allow them to do that, and then we need to move on. You know, because it's almost like, just let me get it out of my system. Let me just do it once. And if they're at that point, and that it'll disturb them not to do it, I allow them to do it. Okay, go ahead, line it up once, then we need to move on. For them, things that are in order, lined up, is very important. And a lot of times, it's one of the first signs that a child is autistic. Parents will say, oh yeah, he plays. He plays with his toy, trains. Trains is one thing. He plays with his trains. He lines them up. They line up things. Instead of really playing with the item, they'll line them up. Yeah, she plays with her dolls, she lines them up. So when you see a child just doing that, I mean, it's okay for a child to line things up, don't freak out. But if that's the only way that they're playing with something, it's because anything that's in order gives them calm. Again, a lot of centering activities. So centering activities, think about it. Let's say someone's at the gym. If you're doing all the, you know, endurance stuff, the cardio, running, this hypes up the system. If you're doing weight training, it's heavy. It's a lot of work. You have to think of your body. You're not lifting a weight and looking what's going around. If it's heavy enough, you have to be in your body. So we want to give them activities that will allow for that. And for children, we'll do, let's say, tunnel activities. Those are great. IKEA sells them for almost nothing, and they close up and they're wonderful. You just put out a tunnel. I'll put pieces in there of puzzles and stuff like that. They go in and they go out to try and get them. They're on the floor, they're grounded. It's a great way to do it. Again, pressure, we talked about, you know, body hugs. Those are wonderful. Give them pressure, you know, throughout the day. When I see some of the kids getting a little too hyper, I'll actually put pressure on the head. And you're not pushing back and forth. You're just doing one, you know, pressure on the head. They love the pressure on the head and pressure on the ears. Something that they love, and on the shoulders, just push down, hold it down. This is a really nice way to relax them. So usually what I do is I actually make kits where I have all these type of little calming activities for the children so that you know, okay, I understand I need to do all this, now how do I get there? Just go ahead, pick out fun activities, and the things that I pick out are usually things that throughout the 10 years that I've been working with them, I see they absolutely love. We talked about predictability again. So one of the best things you can do is establish a routine. I love to use visual schedules. I don't know if any of you know what that is. It's basically a schedule checklist, but we children with autism think in pictures. So we have to give them labels with pictures. There's a visual schedule right here. I make those as well because the ones in therapy are just so ugly. I hate that stuff and I like them to have fun things. Where a child will decide throughout the day what they want to do and do not change the routine. You would think like, oh, they won't notice, let me switch around. They'll notice and it could just completely mess up the entire day.
I think it should be very specific for the schedules that it will wake up, brush my teeth, get dressed, go downstairs and have breakfast. I mean, they love that. They feel such comfort in it and knowing their entire day to the detail. And when they see it on that board, it just totally calms them. It works so well.
One of my favorite tools in therapy is actually the visual schedule. I love to draw, and the kids, like, I happen to be gifted in drawing, so whenever they come in, the first thing I do with them is draw little boxes of what we're gonna do and write down next to it, and then they love going, check, check, you know, and they check it out. It's the cutest thing. And if I forget to do a visual schedule, because sometimes I'm busy and they're already in the routine, they know me, they'll say, schedule. I'm like, all right, the schedule. They love it. They really, really love it. And I think it's one of the best tools for children with autism. It's unbelievable how it just wraps things together. Their behavior just gets better. It's really a wonderful tool. Don't underestimate it. If a child is coming to sleep with you for the first time at the house, I would do a trial run first. Don't do it when the parents are away on vacation for the first time and have them sleep over. It has to be at a time where they can go back home if something doesn't go too well. And make sure also that the family prepared them for it. If they're prepared for something, they can usually tolerate it. In therapy, we'll do a lot of role play. You know, role playing, sleeping at grandma's house. We'll role play, a child takes away a toy from you. We need to role play that. If they know what to do, again, it comes with the expectations, the predictability, all these things, then they're okay with it. Making them feel in control. So again, giving them choices. One of the things we use with them for children that are nonverbal, again, they love the visual cueing. So we give a card that says first this, then that. And this is great for when they don't want to do certain things, like let's say taking a shower. They hate taking showers. So it'll be, let's say they're allowed to do a game on their iPad. So it'll be, you use a card that says, first the visual with first shower, then that. And you do not need to use a lot of words. Don't use a lot of words with them. It's not, oh, if you take your shower so nicely, then we'll be able to play on the iPad. No, it's first shower, then iPad. It's clear. It's right there. And this I'm talking with children that are not just severely autistic, the ones that you see that could get disorganized very quickly. You just keep it simple with them. Keep it simple.
And you know, Nancy mentioned something that I find, I have used the word, well, the expression, in order to, since Leah was about 2 years old, and a therapist taught me that actually, because getting Leah to transition, as Nancy was suggesting, is very, very difficult. So if she wanted to go outside and play, I would say, okay, in order to play outside, this needs to be done, and one or two tasks, that's it. And something about that, in order to, instead of just saying, you need to, I've tried to wipe that word out of my vocabulary with my daughter. You need to. She doesn't, why do I need to do something? In order to do this, this must be done. And if you can like write that down and try to stick to it, it really helps tremendously. It's changed my whole relationship with my daughter. So that's just a little tip. But before Nancy's just gonna give you, we're almost done, but before Nancy's gonna give you some interesting things to do in the community, my mom wanted me to share a story about how you have to prepare the child, as Nancy's always saying, transitions are a very big thing. When Leah was about 10, my mom picked her up from school and took her to Toys R Us. She had a meltdown, she derailed, she lost it in the store, was crying, she just lost it. She didn't understand why a child doesn't want to go to Toys R Us. So later I said, okay, Mom, this is how it, with Leah, this is how you need to present things. First, you can't do something like that when she's tired at the end of the day. You need to prepare her, perhaps a couple days before, saying, hey, Leah, on Thursday after school, Mama's gonna pick you up, we're gonna get a snack, and we're going to go to the toy store. Okay, now, in order to go to the toy store, we're going to pick one item. My mom took her to the store, the lights, it was hot, so many people, the smells, because her sense of smell is so acute, as with many kids in the spectrum. They went to every aisle in the store. It was like a whirlwind, a dizzying experience for this child that she just couldn't handle it. So pick one thing. Are we gonna look for a doll? Are we gonna look for matchboxes? What Play-Doh? You pick that one aisle, and you go in that one aisle when her belly's full, when she has water, and she's relaxed. And then it's a beautiful experience. So you just, as Nancy says, I'm just reiterating, spur of the moment does not work for these kids. Most of us are creatures of habit. So try to think about the idea that we all have these issues. With them, it's just much grander and much more exaggerated. So if we're feeling hot, they're feeling hotter typically. If a noise, the other day a smoke alarm went off in my home, Leah was in pain. I had to put her out in the hall. She was in pain. It's annoying, she was in pain. So that's something to think about. Okay, Nance? Should we show the video now? Or the community, you want to talk about the community? Okay.
So just a few ideas of things that you can do out in the community. You want to pick activities that could be terminated. So you don't want to try a boat ride if your child does not like boating and it hasn't been tried before. It's not the time to try it. If you can't get off the boat, what would you do then? So don't try things like that. It's not time to try new activities. Pick things that you know they've already done, that they love, that's been successful. I know we want to try and give them new experiences, and that's very important also. But if you don't feel ready for either a tantrum or for them to shut down completely, then don't do it. Be ready for them not to be so excited if you brought them to do something new. Always bring with you something that's a calming toy or a calming item, whatever it is. A lot of kids these days, the iPad became, I mean, it's a wonderful thing. It's a cursing and a blessing. But if it's something that's time, then it's not a lot, and that you're not getting them glued to that screen all day, it's a nice thing to bring for them to be able to calm, especially if there's a lot of stuff going on around them. Or there's a lot of fidget toys. Some kids have fidget toys, and that's a nice thing for them to hold on to. You want to avoid crowds, no ball games. No movies, theaters are very overwhelming to children with autism. We think, oh, that would be a great thing because it's quiet, we can all sit down. Actually, the fact that there's no lights and that there's a screen going on and that there's strangers in the room and there's different smells, it is extremely overwhelming. I have not yet met one autistic child that is able to sit in a movie theater. And again, bring items to facilitate communication. The little cards that I usually make say the first and the then. Have something like that in your possession. Know that, have it in your purse. Know that you can just say, show little visuals. First this, then that. We'll do what you want, but first this, then that. And it helps things go smoothly.
We're almost done. We just wanted to show you two videos that we love, and this shows you how cool it is. Starting this new series this morning, An Early Beautiful Memory, in which we will focus on the remarkable Stephen Wiltshire. From an early age, he's been drawing buildings and landscapes in stunning detail after a mere glimpse.
Now, after creating broad panoramas of the world's most iconic cities, we've invited him here to New York to paint his largest work yet. CBS News correspondent Mark Phillips reports.
The really lucky tourists who come to New York City get to see it from a helicopter. And there's no denying the view from up here can make an impression, but few are likely to retain that impression as well as Stephen Wiltshire does.
I'm thinking about the Empire State, Chrysler Building, Midtown, Manhattan, skylines, rest of it, details.
The details are what Stephen sees, where the buildings are, their shapes, the exact number of windows and stories, the architectural flourishes. And these details stick in his mind. Boy, do they stick in his mind. Because after just a brief tour, Stephen can recreate his cityscapes, draw entire urban landscapes from memory. He's done it all over the world, from Tokyo to Rome, Hong Kong to Madrid to London. Stephen has performed this amazing trick 8 times.
You just see it in your mind?
See it in my head. Forget it. Everything in my brain, how it looks.
From a very brief look.
Very brief look.
Now for his finale, he says he's come to New York. Stephen Wiltshire was just 3 years old, a withdrawn child who did not speak when he was diagnosed as severely autistic. But in his special needs school, he started showing a special talent. He had a photographic memory for buildings, and he could reproduce them from memory. His class went to London's ornate Albert Hall. Stephen returned and drew it.
From a picture or
from memory. Then I drew it from the memory. Did it about a few times.
And it came out exactly as it is.
Yeah, how it looks like.
Stephen was already...
So, that's amazing, isn't it? And we would just like to finish up with this.
No instructions or commandments. Laws of gravity.